success, Captain.
Westinghouse Studio One Summer Theater salutes the golden anniversary of the United States Air Force.
Altitude?
70,000.
Speed?
2,110.
Flight attitude?
Level.
Well, Lipton's kept her exactly on course the whole test.
Lipton, the base.
Yes, Gene.
I'm at checkpoint 5.
After you make your turn, Gene, give me a fuel count.
Right. Chase plane to test control.
Yes, Tom.
I'm staying at 50,000.
Right.
Fuel looks okay. Rear fuselage tank, 1,500 pounds. Front fuselage, 1,300. Right tip, 2,000. Left tip, 1,800.
Everything's going fine, Jenny.
Turn 3.8. Speed 2,100.
Gene, let's change radio channels. Go to channel 2.
Right. Say, Mark.
Yeah?
Tell Jenny to stop biting her nails.
General. Gene. Gene, what's wrong?
Chase plane to test control. What is it?
We don't know.
It's Major Sachs, flight safety. Alert the crash vehicles and the search planes. And medical.
I'm sure he got out, Jenny. There was time.
Was there? Pop, you all right?
Get down here!
It's okay, Pop. It's over. Pop?
Yeah?
Where's the pilot?
I don't know. Come on, we better call somebody.
The chief operator. Yes.
Chase plane to test control, searching Desert Sands area. No sign.
Hold tight on the press for a while, General.
All right, General, guarantee. Stand by. You keep this line open for incoming calls.
Jenny, I have to stand by the ambulance. You're not going to try to work.
I know about Gene. I have to do something, Dave.
Chase plane to test control, approaching checkpoint 6. Wait a minute, it looks like the moon streak.
Give me the location.
Crash grid, F-17.
Palm near Desert Sands. Any sign of Gene?
Can't tell, I'll keep looking.
Base to search planes. Proceed to crash site and continue search for pilot. Crash grid F-17. Maintain assigned altitudes.
Coming, Major.
I'll meet you at the crash car in 2 minutes.
Yes.
Repeat. Base to search planes, proceed to crash site and continue search for pilot.
All right.
Crash grid F-17.
Thanks, we've got it.
Major Saxon saw this one.
Well, Gill's one of the best accident investigators in the Air Force.
I know, Leo, but this one's strange. It's not as if the moon streak hadn't been thoroughly pre-tested.
We may have missed something, one of the earlier runs. We'll find out what happened, but it may take time.
I'd better get that plane into production.
General Gerritsen. Repeat that, please. Reservoir, road.
That's right. Don't move him. Gene ejected safely. A truck driver saw him coming down.
Is he all right?
I don't know, Jenny. Get me an ambulance.
Did you get those things to Major Sachs' office?
Yes, sir.
I tell the lab to rush the analysis on that.
Check for carbon monoxide.
Check for everything.
Fuel looks okay. Rear fuselage tank, 1,500 pounds. Front fuselage, 1,300. Why don't they contact me? Moonstreak to base, Moonstreak to base. You guys asleep down there?
Fully protected by the bailout equipment.
The parachute was barometrically adjusted to open at a safe altitude.
Physically, Gene's all right.
Physically?
He's in a state of shock. I don't see any pressure on the brain, though. I think it's purely an emotional reaction.
And how long will that last?
It's hard to determine. Right now, he doesn't even realize he's had an accident. Jenny, we had to expect that.
May I see him?
Well, he won't recognize you.
I want to see him.
I'll see you in your office.
Yes, sir.
Mrs. Lipton.
Yes?
Gene's never had an accident before, has he?
No, he hasn't.
Well, Mrs. Lipton, an accident investigation is a relentless operation. It's very rough on the pilot. Planes crash for two reasons. Either the equipment fails or man fails.
What are you trying to tell me, General?
That Gene's going to find himself being analyzed, like a turbine or an electrical system. He's not going to like it. He's going to feel the whole world's against him.
Well, Gene's a pretty easygoing kind of...
Nobody's easygoing in these investigations, Mrs. Lipton. It'll be rough on you, too.
I'll survive, General.
All right, go ahead.
Gene?
Doctor?
Yes, sir? When do you think we'll be able to talk to Gene?
Sir, that's impossible to say. Frankly, I don't know how much help he'll be to you, even when he comes out of shock. You know, he may not remember very much.
Amnesia?
Well, that's not unusual in cases like this.
Sure, but where will that leave us?
You people ought to stay back by those trees.
That hole must be 20 feet deep.
Well, you heard the noise that thing made.
Will you keep moving, please?
What? Strangest looking
airplane
I ever saw.
Yeah, is it one of ours?
Yes.
Please. 210 yards is a mistake at the nose. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's get a camera and shoot this from a couple of angles.
Right.
Moonstreak investigation.
What's that thing?
That's a portable tape recorder, ma'am. Moonstreak investigation, Lieutenant Maxwell.
Well, don't you have to plug it in?
No, ma'am, it runs on batteries. Interrogation of witnesses, night of the accident, 2100 hours, on the site.
Well, now, that's ridiculous.
Sorry, sir, I'll take that back.
Well, it's just a hunk of metal.
Where did you find this?
Now, wait a minute.
Sir, this is important.
I understand that plane didn't have a pilot.
No, sir, it had a pilot.
Oh, the poor boy.
Well, if it had a pilot, why'd it crash? Was it first flight?
No, sir. Now, can you remember where you found this? It's very important.
Got it. Now, this is where you were standing just before the crash, Mr. Hopewell?
Yes. Craig was over there. We heard this noise, and then we saw the plane coming down.
Uh-huh. Would you show me, please, just what that looked like coming down?
Well, come down? Well, no, something like that.
Start 45 degrees.
No, Pop. It came straight down.
90 degrees.
Craig!
I'm sure it did, Pop. I was looking straight up at it. It looked like it was coming right at me. Just about then, we bolted the dirt. I was over there. Right after the big crash, I saw the first wing hit. Then I went over to see if Pop was all right. While I was running, I saw the second wing hit.
Now, would you mind telling me, Craig, just where you were when the second wing hit?
I was just passing that rock over.
I went over there. Now, look, do you think that you could do the same thing for me now?
You mean in slow motion?
No, nothing like that. Just the way you did when it happened, huh?
Sure. Now?
Yeah, you go on back to your original position. And when I drop my hand, you start running, okay?
Well, what's all this for?
Well, if we can establish precise times, Mr. Hopewell, it may tell us just how the plane blew up.
Oh. Was the pilot still in it when it exploded?
That's one of the things we're trying to find out.
Well, so far, sir, we've got one pretty strong lead. This. Halverson, did you get the photos on this trim control unit?
Yes, sir.
Good. I think we can see it better a little over here in the light, huh? Now, this must have dislodged when the stabilator hit the ground. You see what I mean? Full nose down.
Hmm? So the plane was in a dive, in a steep one, before Gene bailed out.
Well, Gene wouldn't have put her in that sharp a dive, not at the speed he was going. He knew the plane couldn't take that much sudden stress.
Well, he could have panicked.
If he intentionally made a dive setting like this, he must have been in a pretty serious situation. I don't believe Gene ever made this setting.
You think the control system failed?
Yes.
Well, we can test the system tonight. We'll open the shop.
I'll phone Dr. Hines.
Sir. I think we'll have to hold off on that test, sir.
Why?
We don't have all the parts.
What's missing?
The handle from the stick grip with the control switches.
Well, if it hasn't turned up by morning, I'll give you every available man on the base to look for it.
George, you better give it back to them.
Well, what do they need it for?
I don't know, but you never can
tell. I want to take it home for Jimmy.
For Jimmy or for yourself?
All right, Sylvia, just lay off, will you?
Now, George, it bothers me. Now, that might be important.
Just forget all about it.
No, I won't. Now, George, you put it right back where you got it from.
Sleeps most of the time.
It's been 2 days now. Isn't there something you can give him?
Jenny, we've just got to wait till he comes out of it. We're as anxious as you are.
I'm sorry, Dave. Well, I better get back to work.
Jenny. How are you feeling?
Oh, I'm fine, Dave. You know me.
Sure, you're made of iron, huh?
Sir, you're supposed to be in bed.
Lipton Eugene A. I want all his records. Back to the time of his enlistment.
Dave.
Gene.
I cracked her up, didn't I?
Sit down, Gene.
Tell me.
Yes?
When did it happen?
Day before yesterday. You've been in shock, Gene. You're all right otherwise.
That's 2 days ago.
You remember what happened? Nothing?
Well, bits and pieces. I can't seem to make them connect.
Tell me what you remember.
Well, she went out of control.
In what way, Gene?
She wouldn't respond to the stick.
How exactly?
I don't know exactly. She just wouldn't respond. It was like somebody else was flying her.
How did you try to move the stick, Gene?
I don't remember. Where did it happen? On the landing?
70,000 feet.
I don't even remember getting to 70,000 feet. Why don't I remember?
Gene, you were going 35 miles a minute. Whatever the trouble was up there, it happened in less than 10 seconds. Events overlapped in your mind. There were other complicating factors.
You mean panic?
Well, even a test pilot's human.
Well, who's handling the investigation, Gil?
Yes.
Well, has he come up with anything? Has he come up with anything?
No.
Well, how long does this usually last, this amnesia?
Things happen so fast, Gene, you may not have related them. The events may not have even registered in your mind.
You mean I may never remember?
Well, let's see what happens. Now, Gil will want to talk to you.
Yeah, I'm sure he will.
Well, why don't you let me hold him off a couple hours? You go back and get some rest.
What difference does it make? Call him.
All right.
machine had been in an altitude where I could have stayed with him, I might have been able to help.
I doubt it. Whatever it was, it happened too fast.
Yeah, he's right.
Well, anyway, to continue.
From the depth and the angle of the hole made by the engine on hitting the ground, and from the small radius of the entire wreckage area, the plane must have been in practically a 90-degree dive at the time of disintegration in the air. Because at 35 miles a minute, if it had been coming in anything like this, why, the wreckage would have been strewn over the whole county.
Excuse me.
Sure.
Major Sachs. Oh, put him on. Yes, Dave? Well, we could hardly expect him to be cheerful. I'll be over just as soon as this breaks up. Gene's finally out of shock.
How is he?
Well, he doesn't remember much.
Well, maybe with time. All right, let's have your report, Major.
That's how we base this crash profile on planes transmitting it to the test control center. Now, when Gene gave us his last radio signal at 70,000, he was in level flight. 5 seconds later, the nose was 4 degrees down. 3 seconds after that, he was 31 degrees nose down, and he had dropped to 50,000 feet. Within 2 seconds, he'd gone down 10,000 feet, and he was 68 degrees nose down.
From the looks of this telemeter tape, this is where Gene ejected.
That's right.
But you were still recording after that?
Oh, yes, till 30,000 feet.
Well, then the plane was responding to Gene's control when he bailed out.
That's right.
The disintegration happened after that.
And then, until we can test that trim system, we're playing a guessing game. We can't do that till the stick turns up. So anything new?
Nothing. The legal department made a deal with Hopewell so we can plow up his farm tomorrow.
Good.
This is a strange one. I've seen Gene fly through conditions that weren't fit for mortal man.
That's why I assigned him to test the moon streak, to see if a mortal man could fly it.
Waterly. Have you found Mrs. Lipton?
The office said she was off the base, sir. I left a message for her to call you.
Thank you. Is Major Sachs still with him?
Yes, sir.
Gene, before you went into the turn, do you remember anything unusual? Any strange sounds or smells?
Nope.
Smoke?
Nope.
The instruments, did they show anything unusual?
Not that I recall.
Did you feel any buffeting?
Not that I remember. You don't buy it, do you?
What?
I lost the memory.
Oh, come on, Gene. Remember me, I'm your friend. You're not on trial here. All right, I guess we can do without this. Just didn't feel like bringing a secretary along.
Oh, I wasn't complaining. Turn it on.
Gene, when we found the trim control unit, it was set for a dive, full nose down.
Full nose down? I never would have made that setting.
Well, the setting was made in flight. Data we picked up in test control verifies that.
Well, the control system could have run away.
That's what I'm trying to find out, Gene.
Well, have you tested the system?
Well, we haven't found the stick grip yet.
What'll happen if it never shows up?
It'll show up.
Well, it's natural, isn't it, that he'd be depressed?
To a certain extent, yes, but this goes deeper than depression.
I should have been here when he came out of shock.
Billy, I doubt that it would have made any difference.
Dave, is there anything I shouldn't say?
He's not a mental case.
I know that, but...
Well, you just try to be yourself.
Well, that's not so easy.
I know.
Hi, Jenny.
Hi.
You go on in.
I'm all right now. There's nothing to worry about.
I'm sorry I wasn't here earlier. Wouldn't you know I'd missed the great event?
But you thought old Sleeping Beauty never would wake up.
Uh-oh.
Now, why don't you tell me what you did while I was away?
The mending. I mended everything of yours that needed it and everything of mine that needed it. And a few things of mine that didn't need it. What is it?
It's nothing.
Gene.
Well, it's just that the plane took 4 years to develop.
They'll find out what happened and they'll build another one.
It's not that simple.
You'll soon be testing a new model.
Will I? Well, would you take the responsibility after this?
Gene, anything could have caused that crash. You're a good pilot. You've got to believe that. You've got to.
How are the instrument people coming?
Well, they're sending down a man from the east, George Peters, chief designer for Madden Gyroscope.
Oh, good. I'll get this back to you. Oh, is everything possible being done to recover that stick grip?
I still think, sir, it was picked up by some souvenir hunter. Couldn't we use the newspapers to appeal for it?
No, I'd still like to go easy on that. We can't make the public nervous.
Well, who are we testing planes for? It's their Air Force.
Gil, as the public relations boys might say, we have to give that idea the soft sell. Good night, Gil.
Good night, sir.
Find what you were looking for, Dr. Barnes?
Not yet, but we'll try again tomorrow.
Good night, sir.
Good. Send him in. And hold my calls while he's here.
Dave?
You checked out all right, Gene. You can go home today.
Well, thanks.
I'd like you to come back to see me, though.
What for?
Sit down. Gene, you're familiar with the figures on aircraft accidents?
Sure.
The ones where no mechanical trouble was involved, nearly all of them can be related to some kind of failure in the pilot's perception reaction response. I'm not inferring that you're careless or unfit for your job or anything like that, because you wouldn't have been in the moon streak if you were.
Well, there was a time when I took that for granted myself.
You still should. If the investigation should prove that there was no mechanical failure, it may develop that what happened to you up there could have happened to any pilot.
Well, I hope they check into the possibility.
You believe me, they will. If the demands of piloting that plane exceed normal human limitations, then that plane's not ready for production.
You mean human limitations or my limitations?
I told you, any pilot. We've designed planes to break the sound barrier, heat barrier. There's nobody that's come up yet with a new design for the human being. Even the Pentagon can't lick that one.
Well, then, what do you want me to come back for?
All these fragments you remember may not make any sense to you, but they may mean something.
Look, I've told you people all I remember. I've been a pilot for 12 years. I know the signs when there's something wrong with a plane.
Gene, things that are harmless distractions at 300 miles an hour can be deadly enemies at 2,000 miles an hour.
Oh, you think my reflexes failed?
No, Gene.
Well, put me in a maze with some white rats. We'll separate the men from the boys.
Not exactly what I had in mind.
Well, what do you have in mind?
Simply to talk about the things you remember.
What, on Dr. Bergman's magic couch? What is this? When I got my wings, a pilot just had to be a pilot. What does the latest directive call for? A clearance from Freud?
This could help you, Gene. It might stimulate you to remember other things.
Well, you can just forget the sales talk. If you want me on that thing, you're going to have to make it an order.
That wouldn't make very good sense, would it?
Well, then I suggest you stick with the white rats, Doctor.
Ladies and gentlemen, a good evening to you. Tonight's presentation of Westinghouse Studio One Summer Theater
is being brought to you as a salute to the golden anniversary of the United States Air Force. It's hard to believe, isn't it, that military aviation is only 50 years old. 5 decades is not even one lifetime. Millions of Americans have seen the whole drama, and yet we forget how far aviation has come in 50 short years. Now, here are some early pictures of the first military plane. It was purchased from the Wright brothers not long after their historic flight at Kitty Hawk. It was guaranteed to fly 40 miles an hour. Planes have come a long way in the first 50 years. They've grown from 40 miles an hour flying kites to planes that fly 1,400 miles an hour, 25 miles above the face of the earth. In January of this year, a giant like this flew around the world in one hop. When I say the plane flew around the world, what I really mean is the men did. They were men of the United States Air Force. Planes can only do what men have been able to make them do. Men themselves haven't changed very much since the days of Adam and Eve. They haven't changed, that is, except in their ability to get things done. In the field of aviation, men like these have been leaders in what amounts to a new profession. Over the years, flying has been the dream of many men. But it's a long way from a dream to a fact. It has taken a lot more than courage and good intentions to get man off the ground. For 50 years, the United States Armed Forces have given aviation a goal and a purpose. They help to develop flight from a gleam in men's eyes to a practical reality. It was military men who first flew the United States mail around the clock in any weather. We were seeing the age of flight become a fact. Men of the Air Force nursed a plane like this into the air to take man safely through the sound barrier. Today, the speed of the jet age is turning the big world into one large neighborhood. The golden anniversary of the Air Force is a reminder that aviation has grown up in 50 years to become much more than a guardian of peace. It's an economic force in the world, a tool of progress. In the coming age of space, aviation will grow and go wherever men can take it. The future is unlimited. Air Force men like these will help to guide the growth of aviation. They are the men who are learning the special skills and advanced techniques of the aviation profession. From some of the world's best instructors, Air Force men are learning the innermost secrets of modern airplane engines, learning to keep them safe and ready for flight. Now, men like these will become weather specialists. They will play an important part in solving new problems in the age of space. Today's missile program is developing a breed of men who never existed before. They are the men who are learning firsthand the problems that surround the Earth and the space beyond. Solving these problems makes specialists in electronic controls and communications. There is no limit to the knowledge needed and the training available in today's Air Force. Things are happening so fast in the field of aviation that it's hard to keep up with the opportunities and the challenge of the Air Force. Step by step, new knowledge is being gained. New skills are being learned. Air Force men and machines are developing an important partnership that will lead aviation to even greater accomplishments in the years ahead. There are millions of young people in the country today who are looking at the future and asking themselves, what can I do that will give me the most satisfaction and the greatest opportunity to learn and grow? For many of the smartest and most ambitious young men, the answer is the United States Air Force. I urge these young men and their parents to find out how many ways there are to start a rewarding career in the Air Force. Today's Air Force recruiter is much more of an employment counselor than an enlistment agent. He can help you with advice and literature to guide the right men into the right careers. Talk to your Air Force recruiter. And remember, the future of aviation belongs to the eager, able young men who will share in its growth in the years ahead.
Thanks.
Tom Rice called. He wanted you to go bowling tonight.
Oh, I don't think so.
Why not? It'd be good for your figure. Come on, you always have fun. Mother wrote that the new carpet arrived last week, and she says the room's so much quieter and warmer.
Well.
Welcome home. If you come out and confess it's a love letter, I promise I won't read it.
Well, it's nothing. I guess I better get started opening that. What's the matter?
We're so polite with each other.
Well, that's just your imagination. Oh, fine.
Someone might have blown a main fuse. Betty's lights are out, too.
Sure they are. So are Mike's and Sam's and Charlie's.
Honey, they'll fix it.
Yeah, as soon as they get it cleared from Washington. I'm going to call maintenance.
Gee, give them a minute.
Okay. Fuse blew.
I saw the envelope. It was from Kingsley Aircraft, wasn't it?
Yes.
Another job offer?
Yes.
We get them all the time. Why does this one bother you?
Well, because it's a good one.
They always are. Never made any difference before.
Look, Jenny, I'll make three times what I make now. I just don't see the logic in refusing anymore.
When did you start equating logic with money?
Well, what's almighty special about the Air Force?
For 6 years now, I've watched you getting involved in your work in a way I've never seen anybody get involved in anything.
Well, I'll just get involved with $20,000 a year instead.
Will you?
I'll sure try.
You almost killed yourself last week and you crashed an important plane. I wish I could say I know how you feel, but I can only begin to imagine.
What am I supposed to do? Just forget it happened?
No, but $20,000 a year or $20,000 a week won't make any difference unless you stop torturing yourself. All right, where is Kingsley?
It's below L.A. We could get one of those little places at the beach. I'd be home nights. You can't say you wouldn't like that kind of life.
I'd like to quit working, and I'd like a real home. And I wish you danced a better rumba, and I looked like Audrey Hepburn.
Jenny, I'd be working on the ground.
I'm thinking of that.
Well, what are you going to do the next time I go up? More mending?
If I have to. I knew what this was going to be when I married you. Oh, darling, if you really want this job, of course I want it to, but we'll at least wait until the investigation's over. Well, there goes our candlelight dinner.
Honey, what's Dave Bergman's number?
It's in the book.
Sergeant, this is Dr. Peters. He'll be working with the instrument people.
Oh. Right, sir.
How are you? The cockpit fell down over in that direction, Doctor.
Lieutenant, yes. Had Captain Lipton made any comment on the instrument system?
No, sir, not to me. Good morning.
Good morning.
Of course, right now, I can't make that a definite conclusion.
Well, let's face it, Professor. We can't make any definite conclusions till we find that stick grip.
What do you do first? Am I supposed to lie down on that thing?
It doesn't really matter.
Do you find it warm in here?
No, I'm fine.
Did you ever experience the break-off phenomenon up there?
What?
Feeling of being detached from the Earth.
I know you guys had a fancy name for it. Yeah, I've had the feeling. Never in a test flight, sometimes in a long haul. If you're up high enough, you get it. Feels like the Earth just isn't there anymore.
Did it ever upset you?
No, if you're on a long haul, you learn to expect it.
How about the darkness?
What do you mean, night flying?
No, high altitude darkness.
Well, they explained it to you. There's nothing in the atmosphere for the sun to reflect on.
So you're prepared for it?
Yeah, more or less.
You know, Gene, I would imagine that flying a plane with the moon streak's potential, that must be a terrible temptation to take her as far as she'll go.
I lived with that plane from the time it was on the drawing boards, and I knew exactly how much to ask of it.
I just thought the temptation might be frustrating. What holds you back? Orders?
No, look, David. At 70,000 feet, you and the plane are definitely guests. You keep your place.
But a man that goes into test flying, he wouldn't do it unless he had some desire to tame the elements.
If you don't believe me, you can check my records. I never jumped a flight plan in my life.
Ginny, now, what'd you do the night before the flight?
Well, Tom Rice dropped by, and he and Gene went over the flight plan again.
Mm-hmm.
Gene went to bed about 11. He slept like a log.
Are you sure there was nothing bothering Gene? No debts, nobody sick?
The only thing on his mind was the test.
Would you say, Ginny, that he was unusually preoccupied with it?
Not for Gene.
There's one question I have to ask you. Ginny?
Were Gene and I getting along?
Mm-hmm.
I think we had as good a marriage as any two people before this happened. Now I feel like I'm living with a different man. He's even thinking about leaving the service.
I was afraid of that.
All right, George, come in. They told us to see Major Sachs. Are you Major Sachs?
Yes.
My husband has something to return to you.
We've been looking all over for this. Thank you very much.
You see what I mean?
Sylvia, you got what you want. Now will you lay off?
Stick with it.
Yeah. Dr. Heinz, this is Major Sachs. Doctor, could you arrange to set up the test for tomorrow afternoon? Yes, we have it finally. You can? Fine.
What time's the test?
Oh, they said they'd be ready at 3:15.
Well, you've got half an hour yet.
Yeah, I know.
You want to call it quits?
Oh, if you can stay awake, I guess I can.
Gene, you say you remember reporting in at checkpoint 5.
Dave, it's the same old ground and it's full of holes. At the last checkpoint, I remember test control asking me for a fuel count. I remember giving it to him and then telling Ginny to stop biting her nails, and then it's the same blank wall.
The same?
I never mentioned Ginny biting her nails before, did I?
No, you didn't.
Sure, right after I gave Mark the final reading, I remember I thought about her and then I said it. And then I remember thinking I'm going to hear about that tonight at dinner. And right after that, I must have... I'll tell that to the investigation board. The pilot definitely recalls making jokes with his wife.
Gene, you're getting closer. All right, same time tomorrow. Let me know what happens at the test.
Well, it took a while to set this up, but I succeeded to simulate the same hydraulic pressure and electric current that the plane supplied to the control system here, trim control system. Well, there is your hydraulic gauge, and that's your voltmeter. Are you expecting anyone else?
No.
Well then, gentlemen, let's go ahead. What's this? Okay. clear. Looks like it, that your control system was in a healthy shape.
That's absolutely definite, huh?
Oh, yes. You see, the actuator on the plane that the system controlled definitely responded to Captain Lipton's correction. Well, this is an isolated conclusion, of course. In the sense that...
Gene?
Like any part...
Yes, sir. Gene, you heard him. Just one isolated conclusion.
Yes, that I made the setting.
But it doesn't establish why. The reason may be somewhere else. Now, look, Gil, I want to get this thing to a hearing. How soon do you think the other teams will be finished?
Well, most of them have already turned in their reports. And this doesn't conflict with their conclusions.
No mechanical failure?
None so far. The rest of the reports should be in within the next 24 hours. Maybe when we put everything together, we'll come up with the answer.
Good night. Good night, Major.
Good night, sir.
Come to order.
Now, this board of officers appointed under the authority of Air Force Regulation 62-14 is convened for the purpose of determining the cause of the accident to the Moonstreak and to recommend action for the prevention of such accidents in the future. First, may we hear Dr. Hines' report.
And from the basis of the available facts, I found no indications of failure in either the hydraulic or electrical systems.
The fractures suffered by the airplane were instantaneous ones. There's no evidence of metal fatigue.
Therefore, I see no reason to suspect failure in the airplane's power plant.
The deductions of the team are based on data compiled in the test control room during actual flight.
And they indicate nothing to suggest that the Moonstreak was unsound aerodynamically?
Nothing.
We supplemented our tests of what remained of the instrument with a study of previous instrument performance and earlier flights of the Moonstreak. There was no instrument malfunction.
You examined Captain Lipton within 2 hours after the accident?
Yes.
And did you find symptoms of anything that might have interfered with his capacity to fly the test?
No.
This was the final
maneuver that the plane experienced, ending in disintegration here. Captain Lipton says the plane was out of control here. We know it was out of control here. Now, the time in doubt is this period here, approximately 10 seconds. Now then, Sergeant, this was traced from data automatically transmitted from the plane during those 10 seconds. This is the course the pilot directed the plane to take. This is the course it actually took. They are identical.
Then during those 10 seconds, the plane was not out of control.
Apparently, Captain Lipton made that final maneuver trying to avoid trouble that didn't exist. I believe the plane was out of control.
I beg your pardon?
I said I believe the plane was out of control.
From what you can remember, you got that impression here.
It wasn't an impression.
If you had looked at your instruments, you would have found out that it wasn't true.
I must have looked at the instruments.
Well, do you actually remember doing so?
No, sir.
Well, then either you failed to look at him or you failed to trust him.
Well, Captain Lipton, before adjourning this preliminary hearing, have you any other statement to make? Captain Lipton.
No, sir.
Hello? I told you, he isn't home. I don't know. Look, if you want a story, ask the public information office. There isn't any inside story.
Who's on the phone?
Oh, nothing important.
You want anything at the PX?
Going out?
Yeah, I'm going to take a walk. I want to mail this.
Oh, Kingsley'd wait a few days.
What's the point?
Well, the investigation isn't finished.
Well, they got their answer. Captain Lipton's brain is outdated.
I didn't hear them say that.
You got a stamp?
In my purse.
A
Well, let me do that.
It's all right.
Please.
Careful. When did you tell Kingsley you'd be available? What is it?
That plane was banking. Right after I switched radio channels, I remember it was banking to the right and it was pitching up.
What's wrong?
They'd probably never believe me.
Of course they'd believe you.
Oh, no, forget it.
Well, give them a try at least. Where are you going?
Over to Dave's.
Now, look, you were in a left turn, nose about 2 degrees down. Now, we know from the test control records that you brought her back to level flight. But you say you felt then it was banking to the right. So, obviously, you tried to correct for a right bank, but in so doing, you brought yourself back into a left bank again because you were correcting a level plane.
No, I wasn't, Gil. Now, that plane was banking. It was banking to the right, and it was pitching up.
The test control monitors didn't show this plane in either one of those positions.
Well, they weren't just illusions.
Well, let's assume for the moment that they were. Now, look, when you put yourself back into the left bank, you brought your nose down even more. And then when you tried to correct for this pitching up you felt, you brought it even further down. Now, Gene, if you had actually been pitching up, your correction would have brought it back to here. But since we know the plane was actually here, then your correction brought it down to here, about a 65-degree dive, the setting we found in the trim control. Well, naturally, when you found yourself in that position, you knew you couldn't possibly recover at that speed, so you bailed out.
All right, I made the setting. But I felt those things happening. They weren't just illusions.
Well, even if they were illusions, Gene, you still could have felt them happening.
Vertigo?
No, not exactly. Let's call it a disorientation. You know, this can happen on the ground, too. Balance is only a sense of balance, feeling. Your two most important sources of balance are your inner ear and the fixed object your eye can refer to.
Yeah, and at 70,000 feet, and with the attitude of your plane, you had no visual reference points whatsoever.
I had an attitude indicator. I could have looked at that.
Well, that's what puzzles me, Gene. You're not a hot rod driver. You would have looked at your instruments. I think you did. They told you you were not off balance, but this disorientation told you you were. Something had confused your sense of balance severely enough to make you distrust your instruments. Listen, we've established practically every move you made up there. We've got a mock-up of your cockpit. I want you to get in there and run through the entire flight for me. Come on.
Well, this looks like it might be another one of those all-night sessions.
Gentlemen, this is the result of an experiment we performed last night. We've duplicated the position of the control stick and the radio the airplane Captain Lipton was flying. He's now climbing. Level off at 70,000 feet. 10-degree turn. Change the radio channel. Come out of the turn. All right, Captain. If I may, gentlemen, I'd like to repeat part of that sequence again for you. Level off at 70,000 feet. 10-degree turn. Change the radio channel. Hold that position, Captain. Gentlemen, this is an extremely vulnerable position for a pilot to have to assume in high-performance flight. Now, at 70,000 feet, the only source of a man's sense of balance are these canals of his inner ear. When you make a motion, any motion, you disturb the fluid in one of these canals. This fluid sends a message to the brain. Two different but simultaneous motions
will disturb the fluid in two canals. Each canal will send to the brain its own description of our relative position to the Earth. These messages conflict, resulting in a disorientation, a confusion that's sometimes called vertigo. Well, fortunately for us, on the ground, this confusion is harmless, and we're rarely aware that it's even happening. Because the sight of any fixed object orients us, we're able to keep our balance. However, at high altitude, this is another story altogether. Now, Captain, if you will assume the position of changing the radio again, please. The plane had already been banked in a left turn. This had stimulated the fluid in one of the canals. All right, Captain, come out of the turn. Do that again for me, please. Come out of the turn. The sudden and sharp turning of his head, which the position of this radio dictated, stimulated the fluid in the other canal. Disorientation. Captain Rice, would you sit in here, please, assume the radio position? Thank you, Captain. Sergeant, take away the control stick of the radio. I won't need it anymore. General, keep this in mind, please. Captain Lipton was flying at 2,100 miles an hour. I'd like to demonstrate the effect of extreme centrifugal force on a man, any man, that's forced to assume this position. All right, Sergeant. Raise your head. Stand up and walk.
Major Perkins, your last illustration seems rather extreme to me.
Well, granted, this is an exaggeration of what Captain Lipton experienced. But within 2 minutes of the time this reaction took place, Captain Lipton had taken the moon streak up 70,000 feet at 2,100 miles an hour. Now, the stresses on his inner ear were, to say the least, both rapid and extreme.
Can you honestly say that just because of the position of the radio, any pilot would be incapacitated?
Well, Major, would you care to try your luck? Gentlemen, the kind of confusion we've been talking about today wouldn't be dangerous in most of the flights that are operating now. But at the speeds where we're experimenting, a simple thing like the position of that radio can be as important as the design of the entire plane.
Thank you, Major Bergman. Are there any further questions? The hearing's adjourned.
Thanks, Gene. You've given us the answer. Move the radio.
Gene, move the radio up to the front console.
Sure. Now, when do you think you'll have another test model ready for us, Mr. Woodward?
Now, don't pin me down, but soon.
How you feel, sir?
Thanks, Dave.
You really
are. See you around? I'll be here.
That's good, because I forgot to mail that letter to Kingsley.
What letter? Come on, let's go home.
Good work, Gil.
Oh, Dave did it. You know, General, people are always talking about breaking barriers. Well, you don't just break them all of a sudden. You tear them down inch by inch.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Chief of Staff of the United States Air Force, General Thomas D. White.
In tonight's presentation of the human barrier, you have seen a reflection of the care that goes into the investigation of an aircraft accident. Our return for this effort is an Air Force accident rate that has decreased steadily over the years to a present all-time low. This is a remarkable thing, considering the long jump from our former aircraft to high-speed jets. But flying safety receives the concerted attention of virtually everyone connected with flying, from the aircraft designers to the runway sweepers, from top commanders to the newest pilots. And that is as it should be, because no single element is more important to the Air Force today than our people. Trained pilots for a type of high-performance flying never before encountered, and skilled technicians to maintain the complex equipment modern air power requires. We take pride in our safety record, and we will continue to give flying safety every possible consideration consistent with a combat-ready United States Air Force.
Every new mother knows that babies are wonderful. And every new mother soon discovers as well that her little itsy-bitsy cherub is diabolically clever. 1 week from tonight, Studio One Summer Theater will present Theodore Epstein's new comedy, My Mother and How She Undid Me, a frank, startling expose of the continual battle between babies and parents. Ann Jackson stars as the distraught mother who nearly succumbs to the mischievous maneuvers of her child, while the father, a man bewildered by the complexities of parenthood, is played by Larry Blyton. Presented entirely from the viewpoint of the spanking new offspring, the story dramatizes the struggles of a father and mother who discover they are more innocent than their newborn babe. Eddie Bracken guest stars in the role of the clever little cherub whose voice we hear giving commands to the mixed-up matrimonial mates. Other featured players include Nita Talbot and Margaret Hamilton. Be sure to see My Mother and How She Undid Me 1 week from tonight, directed by Seymour Robbie and produced for Studio One Summer Theater by Norman Felton. We salute the men and women of the Air Force Association for a meeting this week in Washington in honor of the golden anniversary of the Air Force. This is Art Hanna saying good night for Westinghouse and inviting you to join us again next week.